Hi, my name is ThePrimeagen. I work at Netflix as a senior software engineer. I stream on Twitch and make YouTube videos. I have a beautiful wife and 4 kids. I created the course Developer Productivity to help you be able to set up new computers, manage your .dot files, be able to switch between projects, and ultimately be able to get more work done with less effort. In this course, we'll cover Ansible and Stow, which will help you get your computer up and running, how to optimize your workflow using tmux, some advanced features of Git, Linux Core Utils, and where the future of programming may go. I hope you enjoy the course. And so SSH keys, they're the worst thing ever, they're the best thing ever. They allow you to have really easy access onto systems, but you either have to generate a new one every time you get a computer and then go to GitHub, go to Stash, go to Bitbucket, go to wherever you have to go, GitLab, and re-put them all in, and then wherever else you have to go. Really, really annoying. Well, Ansible comes with something called Ansible Vault. Now, this thing is pretty darn awesome. So I'm going to give you a little quick example, OK? So let's come in here, and let's create a file, all right? And let's call this one, wow, I already have a test file. What's in here? Oh my goodness. Hello, Frontend Masters. Look at this. We already have a test file. How beautiful is this? So I'm going to take this thing down, and I'm going to run Ansible Vault. And then I'm going to encrypt, and I'm going to choose test file, right? And it's going to say, hey, give me a password. So I'm going to type in a super secret password, and then I'm going to do it again, and that's that. It's going to say encryption successful. So let's cat out the test file. There we go. Now this is what the test file looks like. I could commit this to a public repo. AES 256 is said to be likely quantum secure, so at least for the next while, you're going to be safe using this type of encryption. It seems pretty good. And you can store it on public repos. There you go. It's out there. Everything's fine. And if I wanted to take it, if I wanted to get out the value, I could do Ansible Vault, decrypt, and then, oop, don't want to put that one out there, and then do test file. And I could decrypt the test file, put in my super secret password. And now when I cat out my test file, what do I see? Hello, Frontend Masters. So it's a two-way encryption that works really nicely. But you're probably asking yourself, okay, that's neat. And now I don't have to store my SSH keys, you know, in my email or on a private server. I can actually do that. But still, that's kind of manual, right? I'd have to decrypt them, move them into the correct location. I don't want to do that, right? I don't want to be a part of any of that. You're right. You don't want to do that, and you don't have to do that. So I've included the code, but I'm not going to kind of, I'm only going to just lightly go over the code because it's really, I looked it up on the internet. I pasted it. It worked first try. It was beautiful. I defined a couple vars, where my current SSH key is, where I want to install it, some basic information about it, like, hey, I want to create a directory with the correct permissions, say 700, right? I want to be able to copy my source to my destination. I've also tagged it with .dot files and SSH. So if I install my .dot files, I also need to install these tasks as well. I need to have my SSH keys up and running for my .dot files to be properly running. I do a bunch of this other stuff, set my authorized key so that it works so I can have both. So I'm using it from here on out. If I do a git operation, it's going to be ensured to be working. And of course, I can do something that looks like this. I can go and I can clone down a public repo and then update my submodules, which are private, and it will use my SSH key that I just got done decrypting. So let me show you kind of what that looks like. Here's effectively the exact thing we will be executing. So I'm going to go like this. I'm going to rerun a new Docker, and I'm going to just use my actual Ansible thing I've been using. So here's my Ansible. So I'm going to go Ansible playbook, and I'm going to run .dot files. That's my tag for all my .dot files because I want things to be up and running. And then I'm going to also do ask vault pass, right? And then on top of that, I'm going to just specify local.yaml. Now, I'm going to put in my very secret passcode. Don't look at it too much. There we go. And there we go. It's going to go through. It's going to ensure that SSH is installed correctly. It's going to go through, install omizish, all of that. Make sure vim plug is there. It's going to install that stows there. It's going to clone down my .dot file repository. Not only that, but it's going to recursively get everything else with it. It's going to stow my .dot files. You don't know what stow is yet. Then it's going to get a bunch of my personal projects that I need, and boom, it's done. Now I'm going to open up nvim. It's going to have some errors because I've yet to figure out this one, how to make this thing work. But then I just got to go plug install. And once it goes through and does all of this, all right, blah, 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 blah. There we go. Oh, look how beautiful that is. Everything is wonderful. There we go. And now I can quit. quit. When I reopen up Vim, it's now in the way I would like it. All my keyboard shortcuts work. I can do everything that I wanted to do. Whoopsies. Everything just works as is, because now my Vim's up and running and all my dot files have been there, and they are private with an SSH key. Now, for me, this was a huge thing. That made me really excited, because I've absolutely just hated how I've handled SSH keys in the past. This is awesome. Now it just works, and I can have them stored in a place where I'm not going to lose them, right? And that's a big thing for me, is that I don't want to have to regenerate them, and I don't want to lose them, and I don't want them just on some place that can get hacked. I want them secure. And I feel like this was one of the best solutions I've seen out there, where I can get a system up and running even with those private keys so quick. And I feel like this is one of the biggest selling points of Ansible. But I want to kind of think about it for a second. Besides for SSH keys, what else could we store with Ansible Vault? Well, I feel like everybody here probably knows what this symbol is, right? How many of you are locked out of Binance right now because you've lost your password and you don't have your backup codes for Binance, right? Oh my goodness, you can't get your cryptocurrencies, your millions of Dogecoin just sitting there being wasted away right now. It's because you don't have a way to store your private information easily. So something I've been doing is I've actually been going through my Auth codes, and here you go, here's my Discord backup codes, right? All right, so if I get locked out of Discord, I have my backup codes already here, ready to rock. I don't even have to worry about it. For me, this was just like a huge thing, because this just has, it's gonna save me 100-fold. And so now not only do I have all my installation and everything, I also have all the keys to the kingdom in case things break, in case I lose my phone, all that. I just have to get to a computer and have Ansible installed, and I can get the backup codes back out. For me, this was just awesome. Like, for me, this is just like such a selling point. That's why this talk, I felt like this section went from like the most boring section to the most awesome section, because it's just like, I've been screwed by this so many times in my lifetime, and I don't have to have it anymore. This is kind of an idea right here. Every one of these folders that exist right here, every one of these folders that exist at each one of these levels are likely a Git project or a folder I want to navigate to as quickly as possible. Obviously, I don't want to navigate to somewhere really deep in here, right? I don't need to go to the node module folder somewhere deep down, or a nodes module, you know, that weird thing that happens with node modules. Like, those are the folders that I'm super concerned about, right? Those are the places I want to get to immediately. And on top of it, I love fuzzy finding. For those that don't know what FCF or fuzzy finding, FCF is a specific fuzzy finder. It just stands for fuzzy finding, right? A fuzzy finder. If you don't know what that is, or the best way to kind of say it is that, have you ever used Control P in VS Code, if that's more familiar to you? Control P brings up all of your like files, right? And you can start typing and it finds the file with a few keystrokes, right? That's a fuzzy finder. It means you can type a partial match to a string and it'll return to you all the strings in some sort of sorted order that makes sense. FCF has a lot of options, blah, 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 but it's just a fuzzy finder. It's good to know. This is very, very good to know. All right, so I wanna be able to take these two things and I wanna be able to create a tmux experience out of them, right? I wanna take all of these folders right here and I wanna be able to navigate to them instantly, and I want to filter them via FCF. So that is what I want to create. And we're gonna create that right now, because I want better, faster, smoother navigation. All right, that seems about right, right? So we do know a command, right? We did walk through this command earlier. We can create a session and we can name it, we can detach it. Awesome, mwah, right? It's beautiful, it's exactly what we want. But did you know, I know, oh my goodness, you can create a new session and you can even say, hey, this is the directory I want you to go to, right? So we can actually even tell it what directory to go to with dash C. We can create a new window with a directory it should go to. And we can also call switch client. Switch client will switch to a new client, and it uses this dash T parameter. Now the dash T parameter, you'll put it on switch client. What it effectively does, it allows you to put in a session name. Now I only ever use session name, but you can even go further and do window name and pane number. So you can really give it like a really targeted string to jump to. And so if you name your windows as well, you could even like fuzzy find into that. You could list your sessions and then fuzzy find across it and jump in if you have really well named session and window schemes. It's pretty darn cool. But I tend to just do session name, foo bar, right? So right now, just to kind of show it to you, there's bar. That's one of the sessions name is bar. So we're in foo right now. So I can go tmux switch client. Oh no, I didn't spell that right at all. And then do t and go foo, right? And by doing that, we are currently in foo. I thought I was in bar. So now instead, tricking you guys, making sure you're paying attention, we press bar and we jump over to bar. So look at that. I programmatically switched sessions. So we're like, okay, we have a lot of the tools here to create this style of navigation, right? We know that there's commands that exist that we can do this with. We know that we know what folders we want to do it, and we know that we want a fuzzy finder to be able to help us. So there's like kind of a lot of things going on here. And lastly, there's another command that I have right here that we don't need this time, but we're going to need pretty near, or you may want soon, is you can also include a command right here. So not only can you create a new window with a name, you can also say, hey, run Node.js, whatever, right? So you can actually tell it to do something. And lastly, always read the friendly manual. I believe that's what that abbreviation stands for, RTFM. Always read the friendly manual. It's very important to do that. And so man tmux actually has a lot of information inside of it. If you're not familiar with man, which stands for manual, do man. It will tell you actually how to read a manual and what it means, what each one of these numbers mean. Along with it, it'll even tell you like, oh, bold means type it exactly as shown. Okay, so let's go back to tmux man. Look at that. This means type it exactly like this. Tmux, like it actually gives you a lot of information. And once you read through the man's manual, it makes a lot more sense reading manual pages. They're very, very nice. And tmux is particularly nice because it has like everything in it. You're confused at how switch client works. Well, here you go. Here's every single option, all of it. Here's the alias that it's also known by. Here's everything that it can possibly do. It's very, very nice to learn these commands using this little manual page. Always recommend reading the friendly manual. So now we have our items we can easily search for and easily fuzzy find over. Now, obviously, I could make this a really big list, but for the point of this, I don't think I need to make this as big as possible. It just needs to be obvious how it works. So there we go. We have these two things, and now we need to select the thing we want. So really, we could do FCF, right? Pipe that into FCF. Perfect. So let's just try it out. Here we go. C, boom, C. Oh, beautiful. Just always makes me feel so good when things just work how you want them to work. So now, of course, selected. Little one of those. There we go. Everything's great. Look at that. We're practically done with our script at this point. It's fantastic. Now, I also learned this recently, fumbling around trying to make the script a couple weeks ago on Twitch when people repetitively told me that I am a script kiddie and I don't know what I'm doing. Well, let me show you me knowing what I'm doing. We're going to echo out languages, and we're going to pipe it into grep, and we're going to do QS. Effectively, we're making it silent. We're not returning the results, and we just want to know, did we find it or did we not find it? Is selected within the languages, right? Because remember, if we look right here, when we use languages, it's like a different way we do it. It's a space delimited item. When we use core utils, it's not a space delimited item. Again, oh my goodness, so straight. So here we go. So let's jump into here, go right there. Let's just prove it, right? Let's go like this. Echo, I am language, right? Take that, FL, go here, and then go, I am core util. There we go. Util. That's how I say it. Is that normal? Probably not. All right, let's cheat sheet. Let's try it with sed. I am core util. Perfect. Let's try TypeScript. I am language. Oh my goodness. This is going so good. Everything's working. By the way, this is how I develop bash. For anyone that wants to know, whenever I'm doing bash type things, I go back and forth like this a lot because bash is just, I never get it right. It's like this is like such a hard language. I swear, it feels so easy, but I get it wrong every single time. We have this, so now what we need to do is we need to create that curl command, right? So let's try this. Let's go like this, curl cheat sheet, and then we got our selected, right? That's the thing we selected. And since we're under the languages, all we gotta do now is go like this, echo, we need a query, don't we? We need like a query. So let's go like this, read P, and that P stands for prompt. Give me your query, right? There we go. And we're gonna make it go into variable query. So we're gonna echo query down here, and we're gonna pipe it into tr, right? And tr, we're gonna wanna replace every space with plus signs. Now, for whatever reason, I've decided right here, I wanna use single quotes, which just seems asinine to use single quotes in one single spot in your entire language. There we go. So this should do exactly what we think it should do. It should curl cheat sheet with our selected language and then have our plus delimited query string. Down here, we're gonna wanna do it just a touch different. Instead, we're gonna wanna do that little tilde and go query, right? Query, awesome. So that should do the other part of it. So if we do find exec, this should work. So let's find out. Let's go like this, let's quit it. Let's go in here, wrong script. And let's go, I just quit Vim. Let's open up Vim because it just feels better, right? There we go. Let's go over here and let's go cheat sheet. And let's use, did I add find? Oh, I did add find. So there we go, we got find, give me your query. Let's do exec, right? All right, there's everything that has to do with exec right here. Awesome. So like this is really working, right? I feel like we're really doing something. Awesome, okay, this is looking good. But the problem is we're not tmuxed out of our mind yet. Right now, we're still just kind of lightly tmuxing, and I don't want that. I want to I just want this to be the greatest thing ever. So how should we go about this? So let's think about that. We have two options. We could create a new pane, in which I've never done, and someone suggested, and honestly, it kind of feels like a great challenge. So let's try a new pane for a second. If not, I'll just fall back to the way I already pre-planned, but we're going off script now, okay, people? We're going all in on this one, I know. This has to be the one. It has to be split. Create a new pane by splitting the target pane. Okay, does a horizontal split. V does a vertical split. Awesome, okay, so I'm a vertical kind of guy. So let's try this out. So we're gonna go with this, tmux split window, and my guess is it's dash V for vertical. This is feeling good. We won't provide a target because I'm gonna assume that if there's no target, it does my current window. Split window, you never know. Oh yeah, never mind. Split window, it's right here, shell command. Okay, all right, and we even have starting directory we can do, environment, we can provide environment variables. Really cool, by the way, that you can provide environment variables. That means you could actually have certain things in this, and you could like start a DB, you know, environment, which already has all your connections and everything. A lot of cool things you can do here. So I think this should probably be okay. Let's go like this, split window vertically, and then let's just do this. So let's go like this, let's go bash dash C, and let's just pass this into less. Less is like a super duper ultra cool program. Okay, I'm gonna be, let's see, hold on. We got a lot of escaping to do here. Let's escape with passion and fury. I don't think I need to escape those ones. Well, let's just see. I don't think I need to escape anything. Let's just find out. All right, so let's do this again. Oh, I keep closing my Vim command there for a second. So let's do cheat sheet. Let's do TypeScript. Let's do enum. And there we go. Yes, first off, tmux is backwards, which part of me just feels very upset. And so let's go back into Vim now, and let's go back to your little cheat sheet. So there we go. So we just piped into less so it would work. And then of course, let's fix that very poor vertical thing to make it horizontal. And let's run it again. I closed Vim again. Clearly out of my element here, enum. And there you go. Now I have this. And so now I can scroll around here to see what's going on. So obviously there's nothing here. So the moment I press Q, it quits. It also quits the split. We're back here. That's actually pretty cool. That's a pretty good experience right there.